a part of a Lilly grant that we have, and we're going to talk about the biblical and theological foundations of financial stewardship today. Stewardship is a more holistic concept, and that will be mentioned briefly, but we do want to focus this morning on financial stewardship. That's the one that's more difficult for many of us to talk about. I want to begin reading from an article that has a picture 15 years out of date, so I really appreciate that. It comes from the Lutheran July. Sadly, for many, stewardship means raising money for the church. In the Bible, a steward is the manager of another person's property. This definition can make stewardship sound like a job where we are employed by the owner. But it's really a fundamental aspect of Christian discipleship, involving holistically how we live and how we give. Stewardship is a response of gratitude and thanksgiving for what God has done for us and the world in Jesus Christ. It is a way of discipleship, of embodying God's grace and love to people and the world in need. We are now going to hear a variety of different biblical theological images lifted up for you that we hope will be very evocative and engaging in our discussion.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
All right, today I'm going to be talking about the vocation of stewardship. All right. And basically where we find our foundation for it. So there are three key principles for stewardship. It's an identity given to all humans. And it's also a theological concept. We are people participating in God's mission through stewardship. Stewardship is also a key spiritual practice. All right, so now if we look at Genesis, which is the beginning of all of our faiths, and we have to look at that to see where all this idea of stewardship came from. So in Genesis, we see that God alone is the source of all life. God's faithfulness and benevolence and abundance is given to us to care for. The goodness of creation. We need to understand that creation is good, our bodies are good, we have gifts that are good that we can give to others and share with others. And the gifts that are given to us are good and have no aesthetic value of denying the needs of the world because of them. Human beings were created in the image of God, and that is great relational acts that we have to do. So we talk about Adam. How many of you have ever heard of Adam? He was the first steward. And if you need a definition of steward, it's a person responsible for the care of an item or place, as Anne had already previously mentioned. Humankind was entrusted with ruling over or caring for the rest of creation. And so we hear that in the words of dominion. And many people fear the word dominion because they think it's like putting down or pushing down. But it's actually God's sovereignty, God's creation that we are caring for. So how do I implement these, you say? I know you're all saying that, right? So we must remember that all things that we have come from God. None of it is ours. It's all God. I know that's hard. It's hard to understand. We are to care for all that we have been given and use it for the good of all. This includes human resources, natural resources, generated resources. We are to be fruitful and multiply. Following confirmation, and I heard that, I'd laugh super hard, but it's not just the literal meaning. It means that we have gifts, like I just talked about, gifts of God that need to be shared, and we need to help people discover their gifts as well and be able to do that. And multiply, we need to bring people into the kingdom of God, and we also need to help them understand that what they have to offer is good. We are to live in relationship with one and all. That means even people who are not Christian, people who are not necessarily of the same belief system of us, but this whole creation was given to us for the sake of stewarding it together. We are also responsible for the well-being of creatures. In this concept, we are to work for the rest of all of the people. We are to work for justice for all, and we are to care for the vulnerable, sharing God's gifts. And we need repentance for our wrongdoing. Wealth is not a bad thing. It is only bad when it is used as an idol or in harmful ways against other people. Right? Yes. Thank you.
So thinking about specifically in the scope of financial stewardship, money. Money is not an idea that is foreign to the scriptures at all. In the NRSV translation, it's mentioned 181 different times. That's only the word money. That's not involving things like what it means to be, you know, to have debt or to owe to others and so forth, as well as, you know, a barter system of sheep and such. So we live in this tension surrounding money's use. It's great when we have it, right? It's sometimes very difficult when we don't. But one of the things we have to remember is that money does not exist in an evil way. It's not evil. The first letter to St. Timothy says, does the love of money is the root of evil, of all kinds of evil. In Hebrews, we read that it is to keep yourself, that there's an admonition to keep yourselves free of the love of money and be content with what you have. And when Jesus sends out the disciples, he sends them out without money. The idea that we live in this tension of both need and care for one another, as well as to make sure that it does not become the most important thing. Money, when it's stewarded appropriately, can feed people who are hungry, build homes for those who have no home, and serve all of God's people in love. That's a really important concept, and we see that time and again in the scriptures, especially thinking about the early church and the Acts of the Apostles, where they shared everything in common and no one was without, and no one had any need. When misappropriated, it can do the opposite of these things. Luke's gospel, time and time again, refers to systems of which existed and where people were taken advantage of because of the money. This is especially true when we use the stewardship, and Dave will probably talk a little bit more about this, the widow's mite, where it's actually the temple structures that are taking advantage of the widow in the case of not that she could give her last cent. It's a horrible thing, and we have to think about how that works. Luke's gospel, along that same time, reminds that you cannot serve both money and wealth, of which Luke has does not shy away from the same Pharisees, describing them as the Pharisees who loved money, and puts them in that kind of light. To think about it in Lutheran terms, when we look to the confessions, and especially the large catechism, there's two places that we have to think about money's place. The first Luther's explication of the first commandment of the large catechism, which leads us to the idea of trying to seek life in things which are not life-giving. Money in and of itself is a created thing, but it cannot give life. God alone can do that. Looking further from that, we look at the first article of the Creed, where money is created, and God remains the source. So you end up in this place of being in this healthy tension between what its necessity in our life, in our family's lives, the mission of the church, service of the neighbor, and that tension requires stewardship. This is a really difficult tension in that stewardship, especially when we think about from Romans not owing anything to anyone, and the number of us who are gathered here today who are going on paying for their seminary education through student loans. You know, there's a tension of which has to be lived in. But by being aware of our own self-understanding of money and practices in which to steward it, by the grace of God, we can live in this tension. And it can be a good place for us to be. Above all, we must always remember, or be invited to remember, that it's God who is the source of life, salvation, and healing. Isaiah 55 invites God's people to come without money to the God who saves them.
So I've been asked to talk about how we engage the topic of financial stewardship within the context of a congregation, and more specifically, how do we do this from the pulpit? So I'm curious, and you don't have to raise your hands, but what I want you to do is to close your eyes for a second. This isn't an option, don't sleeping. And I want you to think about the first image that comes to your mind when you hear stewardship campaign. Okay, open them up. Some of you may have got great experiences. You've had good experiences with congregations that have a healthy approach to this. Some of you may have had experiences, like I've had many times in my past, with stewardship campaigns that are filled with guilt. But what would it be like if we, as future leaders within this church, incorporated more fully into our preaching and teaching a biblical understanding of financial stewardship? Is this even possible? I think that it is. And I'm going to tout a book today. This book right here, entitled Preaching and Stewardship, Proclaiming God's Invitation to Grow, written by Craig Satterlee. I'm going to talk about it a couple times throughout this little speech here. But it invites us to rethink our approach to preaching about money through the use of the Revised Common Lectionary. And instead of engaging financial stewardship only through the use of the once per year campaign, whether healthy or not, Satterlee encourages us to let the lectionary be our friend. He invites us to let the many ways in which money is included in the biblical narratives of the lectionary to be a part of the discussion as well. It's not just a one and done. It's more inclusive and it's more holistic in our proclamation. All right, now, we've heard it mentioned a couple times already this morning, and this is probably going to seem like a silly question, and you don't need to answer it out loud. But what is it that should rest at the core of our sermons about financial stewardship? Who said Jesus? You weren't supposed to answer out loud, Jenny. Right. Agreed. But Satterlee reminds us that in whatever narrative we choose to preach from about stewardship, that when we think about our giving, this is an expression of something bigger and more profound than our church, our individual congregation. We give to God in response to all that God has given to us, particularly in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, and as a way of sharing in God's own will for and work in the world. The core of the stewardship sermon is not just about money. The core is about the gospel. So, in talking to people about financial stewardship, questions usually come up like, well, why do I have to give? What does the Bible say about giving? How much do I give? Anybody ever encountered questions like these before? This one you can go like this with. Or like, okay. So, Satterlee offers up a couple of questions throughout his book that address these particular issues. So the first question that I'm just going to spend a moment with is the question of, why does the Bible say to give? Other than that answer that I just gave a second ago that Jenny lifted up for the community. So Satterlee points out a couple of places. Now, what I'm going to draw upon right now are places where the lectionary provides us with a narrative in which to engage. For example, giving is an act of worship. Okay, why do we give? It's worship. We can find this in the story of the anointing of Jesus at Bethany in Mark 14. Giving is an act in participating in God's mission in the world. Ron already brought up the connection to the end of chapters 2 and 4 in the book of Acts, but it's also present in the Gospel of Matthew in chapter 25, "For I was hungry, and he gave me food." Another place where we can see this. Another way that we give is growing in grace. We hear in 2 Peter 18, "But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ." Satterlee extends this a bit and says that, quote, "The spiritual discipline of giving, like worship and prayer and works of charity, this is a way that we live out the salvation we receive from Christ, not as a means of earning that salvation from Christ, but we ask God to continue to shape us into the image of Christ through this practice." Giving is a spiritual practice. Another big question that Satterlee addresses in this book is how does the Bible say we're supposed to give? Again, from the lectionary, here are some answers. Give gratefully. The key to giving gratefully, according to Satterley, is receiving from God gratefully. We can see this story uplifted in the 10th leper who returns to thank Jesus for healing, found in Luke chapter 17. We also find wrapped up in this one verse from 2 Corinthians the idea of giving freely, cheerfully, and intentionally. 2 Corinthians 9:7 says, each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves
a cheerful giver.
Excellent, a cheerful giver. We also hear in 1 Corinthians 16:2 that each of you is to put aside and save whatever extra you earn. This is intentional giving. These are places that are uplifted from the lectionary, readings that exist in the Revised Common Lectionary. And the last point here, he says, how do we give according to the Bible? What does it say? To give generously. 2 Corinthians 8 says that Paul praises the church in Macedonia as they give through their hardship, they give generously through their distress and their difficult times. And in Galatians, we hear in chapter 5 that generosity is a fruit of the Spirit. And so, what would it be like if you allowed your proclamation to be more shaped more fully by these many and varied biblical narratives about money? How might our attitudes and behavior towards financial stewardship be transformed if we shape our proclamation about money not in a way that focuses on guilt alone or at all, or about paying the bills, but instead in a way that allows God's goodness to take hold of our lives and transform us according to the gospel.
Thank you. Let me just briefly summarize a few main points, then, and we'll get to table discussion. One, financial stewardship is not about legalism and law and command. It grows out of our identity and vocation, our identity of being created in an image of God who is generous and abundant beyond all belief and understanding, the Father generously creating life in all its diversity in the universe, Jesus generously giving up his life on the cross for us, the Spirit generously giving us gifts and inviting us into the body of Christ. And that's another identity for us. Gathered as the community of the body of Christ, we are welcomed into Christ's stewardship of the world. Jesus is the primary steward of all things from God. Through his life and ministry, his death and resurrection, he healed those in need, welcomed and brought hospitality to the outcast and unloved, and proclaimed God's rule of justice, love, and peace. We are invited into Christ's continuing mission of healing and reconciliation and doing the kingdom work of justice and peace. Some of this can be done through our time and our talents, and some of this through our money that will go places we never can be. Paul also tells us that part of our identity is stewards of the mysteries of God's grace. And this includes God's life-changing, transforming power to make us into the people of God that God has created us to be. And so you've heard talk about stewardship as a spiritual practice of growing to trust in God, to let go of needing, to trust in abundance rather than fear and be anxious about scarcity. Henry Nouwen once said, every time I take a step in the direction of generosity, I know I am moving from fear to love. And as disciples, we are called to love God with all our heart, soul, strength, and mind, and our neighbors as ourselves. And we can do that through stewardship. Martin Marty, in perhaps a slight exaggeration, says the overarching theme of Scripture is the abundance of God. Now, that doesn't mean every particular text points that way, but that's what his claim is, that the overarching story is about God's abundance. And so we invite you now to look at questions, to pick those that will interest you deeply, including what Bible stories are your favorite stories, and do they reflect God's abundance? As we think about who we are, our identity, and what we are called to do, our vocation as disciples and stewards. Thank you to Ron and Dave and Kim for their presentations.